answers. Okay, if I can welcome you to this, the 8th meeting of the Public Petitions Committee, and can remind members and others in the room to switch phones and other devices to silent. And I can also welcome Alison Johnson, MSP, here, who's here for the first agenda item, which is a consideration of continued petitions. And the first of these is Petition 1615 on state-regulated licensing system for game bird hunting in Scotland. The first item for our consideration this morning is Petition PE1615 on a state-regulated licensing system for game bird hunting in Scotland. This is our third consideration of this petition, having previously heard evidence from the petition on the 27th of October and then considered a further paper at our meeting on 10th November. At that meeting, we agreed that in the interests of balance and impartiality, we would invite representatives of the Scottish Moorland Group and the British Association for Shooting and Conservation to provide evidence to us to assist with our consideration. As the witnesses and members know, the petition relates to issues of wildlife crime, and the Wildlife Crime Annual Report will be considered by the Environment, Climate Change and Land Reform Committee. However, in taking evidence and then considering what action we wish to take, it would be helpful if the ground we cover today focused on the issues as they relate to the call for a licensing system. And I'm pleased to welcome Tim Baines, Director of the Scottish Moorland Group, and Dr Colin Shedden, Director of Scotland for the British Association for Shooting and Conservation, to this meeting. Can I thank you for attending today? You have an opportunity to provide a brief opening statement, after which we'll move to questions from the committee. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Convener, and we're most grateful for the opportunity to be here this morning. The petition clearly calls for a state-regulated licensing system for game bird hunting in Scotland. In reality, this would license all game bird hunting, which would include rough and walked-up shooting, as well as driven shooting, and the shooting of pheasant, partridge, ptarmigan, woodcock and snipe, as well as grouse. This would affect all who shoot game, whether reared and released or wild. This could affect the vast majority of the 49,000 shotgun certificate holders in Scotland, as well as the many thousands of people who come to Scotland to shoot each year from all over the world. Shooting is a substantial rural industry in Scotland that influences the management of about two-thirds of the land and supports the equivalent of 8,800 full-time job equivalents. More importantly, the conservation work carried out by shooters from all walks of life is the equivalent to 3,900 full-time workers. The argument has been made that game bird hunting in Scotland is the least regulated in Europe and North America. Game bird hunting is regulated in Scotland, initially by the Game Act dating back to 1832, and much more recently by the Wildlife and Countryside Act 1981, as amended, and the Wildlife and Natural Environment Scotland Act 2011. That was the act that introduced vicarious liability, for instance. Those who participate in game bird hunting are also regulated by some of the toughest firearms legislation to be found in Europe. Those who hunt game are already regulated. They will have to have a shotgun certificate. That means that they've already been vetted by the police, and as noted in the Wildlife Crime in Scotland 2015 report, such certificates can be revoked and wildlife crime could be considered relevant in such a revocation, and that is at a civil burden of proof. While shoot licensing may not exist in Scotland, nor anywhere else that I know of in Europe, game bird hunters are effectively licensed very much in the way that the petitioners desire. In addition, SNH now has powers to withdraw the general licences that allow essential management activities to take place. These can be withdrawn from landholdings suspected of being involved with wildlife crime, and this has happened. We therefore have a wide range of both civil and criminal law, including vicarious liability, which amounts to unusually stringent legislation. And we're also waiting for the introduction of stiffer penalties for wildlife crime. As I've outlined, and contrary to the petitioner's claim, game shooting in Scotland is well regulated, and this regulation has been updated on a regular basis. The petitioners also claim that shooting is underpinned by illegality and that persecution is endemic. Shotgun certificate holders are among the most law-abiding sector of society, and any hint of illegal activity can lead to the right to hold a certificate and the ability to shoot being withdrawn. In recent years, there have been an average of about 5 poisoning incidents in Scotland, 5 too many, we would agree, but considerably fewer than suggested by the petitioners. The fear of the cost and the bureaucracy surrounding any shoot licensing scheme, on top of the current legislation and regulation faced by land managers, could act as a real disincentive and may lead to shoots being abandoned and important conservation work deserted. Much of the existing stringent legislation that is in place is recent, and we suggest that this will continue to make a significant contribution to efforts to eradicate wildlife crime without the need for further regulation at this time. Thank you.
Thank you very much for that. You said that the regulation current was unusually stringent.
Yes.
In terms of other countries?
I would say in terms of a UK context, the legislation affecting those who shoot in Scotland is probably tougher. In fact, it is tougher than the legislation that applies in England, Wales and Northern Ireland. So in that UK context, Scotland probably leads the way in effective legislation to tackle wildlife crime.
Okay. And can I ask, in what circumstances and what type of evidence of general licence has been withdrawn?
General licences have been withdrawn recently on two areas in Scotland, and they've been withdrawn by SNH because of the suspicion of wildlife crime having taken place on these two properties. That withdrawal of the general licence has been challenged, and I believe it's going to judicial review in January.
Okay, and when there were proposals for the current regulated scheme were being introduced, would your organisation have been in favour of those, or did you resist them at that time?
We had certain reservations about the restrictions of general licences, but we recognised that it was probably a reasonably cost-effective way to challenge or to maybe ensure that wildlife crime is being properly addressed. As I say, there's judicial review coming up in these two sites, so I'd probably better wait till that has been heard before I could say any more. But we generally are supportive of any steps that are taken to fight wildlife crime, and I'm happy to expand on that later.
Okay, thank you. Rona Mackay.
Yes, I note that the Scottish Land and Estates consider that new penalties regime arising for the review of wildlife crime penalties in Scotland is the icing on the legal structure. I'm just wondering if you share this view, and if you do, can you expand on why?
Yes, I mean, we generally support the outcome of the Professor Pusty's review because it looked at the issue and it came up with a number of solutions, some imaginative new penalties and also toughening up the tariffs, which had got very sort of out of date. I think they'd last been renewed in the 1990s. So we generally support that as a measure that would deter wildlife crime, and it seems entirely sensible. I know they've not been announced yet, but I think there's a general assumption that they will be adopted as recommended, but I can't be sure.
And you think
that
it goes far enough in that sense?
Yes, I think it, as I say, the icing on the cake is because, as Colin said, there is a pretty tough regime of wildlife crime, and this will be, you know, this will be an extra disincentive or deterrent by increasing the tariff of penalties.
Okay, thank you.
Donald?
Okay, thanks, Convener. Good morning, Dr. Fred. Good morning, Mr. Baines. I think it's fair to say that the issue of vicarious liability has received a mixed reception since its introduction in the Act in 2011. And you yourself, Dr. Shedden, have referred in your preamble to the unusually stringent legislation. I'd be keen to know what your views are on the impact of the vicarious liability provisions within the 2011 Act and how you think that's progressing, and also in particular get a picture of how that's impacted on land management practices.
I think the most, I'm sure Tim would like to answer. Tim also has a short opening statement that maybe we could take at some point. With respect to vicarious liability, the main impact that it's had is probably to ensure that any contract of employment is explicit in the fact that no wildlife crime will be tolerated, no use of poisons will be tolerated. So practically every gamekeeper in Scotland and everyone employed in the land management sector will be under a contract which is explicit that there will be no tolerance of wildlife crime. And that, I'm sure, in the coming years will have a considerable impact. Those who employ land managers obviously have to protect themselves, and the main defence will be to ensure that the contract's in place and that there's ongoing training with respect to ensuring that everything is above board.
Okay. I don't know if you want to respond as well, and maybe if you want to add your statement at this point, do so.
Yes, well, if I may, could I just make a brief opening statement to cover? This is particularly because much of the evidence behind the petition seemed to revolve around Grismore's, although it is, you know, it's for all types of shooting. And just to cover one or two of those points, I mean, I'm again, thank you for the opportunity to come here today. I'm talking on behalf of the 2,500 or so people who operate Scotland's 140 Grismore's. And they are passionate about the work they do, looking after the uplands and the birds and the habitats. The petitioners say that environmental concerns are behind their call for licensing, but there is solid evidence that, that the Muirburn, the predator control and the other work that goes on moorlands really, you know, is a positive net contribution to the environment, for instance, helping waders, which are fast declining elsewhere. I mean, Colin has outlined the regulations, and there is a long list of other things that keepers have to abide by every minute of the day. They are very heavily regulated in terms of what they do. And the petitioners have not really put forward any detail of how licensing system could actually add to all that regulation that is there. As I say, the petition rests mainly on Grismore's, but we don't recognise the picture that the petitioners are painting about how Grismore's are managed. I mean, we are very clear that we condemn any form of wildlife crime, and we're members of PAWS like them and share the same objectives. But the evidence shows that grouse shooting is not sustained by criminality, as they allege. So what we'd like to just mention is the very positive impact that the tighter regulation, particularly in the last 5 years, has had, and the actions of the PAWS partnership. I mean, there is a lot of partnership working on this issue. We question why the RSPB chose to refer to their own report, which goes back over the last 20 years, rather than focusing on the last 5 years, which we think is the most relevant. You mentioned earlier the new government wildlife crime report, which I think hadn't come out at the last time the committee met, that's been mentioned in the agenda. It is broadly speaking, there shows to be a continuing gradual decrease in wildlife crime over the last 5 years, and the raptor figures we think are about the lowest for the last certainly 3 to 5 years. What that seems to suggest to us is that the current measures are working. Another thing the petitioners said was that there are crimes going undetected, and this is something that is often mentioned. But earlier this year, in his evidence to Parliament, Assistant Chief Constable Graham, he didn't accept that there was a tip of the iceberg issue, as is sometimes said, and he actually said, we are not missing the vast majority of what is going on here. We've also helped on the other side of the coin to try and develop voluntary schemes, particularly the Wildlife Estate Scotland initiative, which is supported by government. And there's currently 43 estates that are now accredited, covering 1.1 million acres. And there's another 29 that are under assessment or forming up to be assessed in the next year or so. We're also work in other partnerships, such as the Heads Up for Harriers with PAWS and SNH, the South of Scotland Golden Eagle Project, which is just getting going after many years of gestation, and the East Cairngorms Moorland Partnership. And all of these have raptor conservation at their core of what they're trying to do. So we are doing everything we can to voluntary initiatives to help with raptors in particular. And we don't recognise the impression given by the petitioners that Grismore's are raptor deserts. I mean, since the last time the committee met, we've seen the Golden Eagle Survey published, which has shown a 20% increase in golden eagles since 2003. And many of those are on managed Grismore's. We do have, if it is of interest to the committee, we do have a positive four-point plan, which we think could deal with this issue once and for all, hopefully, which we're very happy to discuss with the committee. That's all I would say.
Thank you very much for that, Angus.
It would be good if you could share that four-point plan with us. In fact, it would have been good if we'd had that in advance.
Right, OK, I wasn't sure how much time to spare. The first point one would be we very much support the continued enforcement of wildlife crime. I mean, this is absolutely essential. There is a tough regime, and that needs to be continued to enforced, and the tougher penalties that we discussed a little bit earlier would help that. So that would ensure that the current momentum is maintained. Secondly, we would ask for support and development of the Wildlife Estates Initiative and the other collaborative schemes, projects going on, because, I mean, other sectors such as farming and forestry, they have their own accreditation schemes, which I think are very effective. Wildlife Estates is, it's a rigorous accreditation scheme. It can't be done in 5 minutes, so it started slowly, but it is on the rise, and more estates are signing up and being accredited. And these sort of formal initiatives actually make working together with people like the RSPB and the Raptor Study Groups, they make it a lot easier because there's a formal framework that we can operate together in. And so we would say that it is that sort of cooperation which is the way ahead. Thirdly, one thing is the, you may be aware of the Understanding Predation project, which was run by the Scotland's Moorland Forum, and that was all stakeholders across the board came together to look at this whole question of predation and how that can be managed. It was a groundbreaking scheme, and at the moment they're working on the next stage of that, which will be a sort of live management project with everybody involved. It'll draw on the sort of proven methods of environmental conflict resolution. And we think that is a very important way of everybody moving forward together on an understood scientific basis to deal with the issue of predation. And then finally, the fourth point, we would very much like to see greater cooperation between ourselves and the Raptor Study Groups and the RSPB. I mean, we have tried hard on this. For instance, just this year, with the help of SNH, we developed a new protocol for national bird surveys. Last year, it was the Golden Eagle. This year, it's been the Hen Harrier survey, to try and build better working relationships, better trust between the people on the ground and the people doing the surveys, which has got a bit strained over the last few decades. And we're very keen to try and rebuild this relationship, because it is only by working positively together we're going to deal with these issues. That in a nutshell, is our four-point plan.
Okay. Thank you.
I think that's very useful. Thank you very much. Maurice Corrie.
Yes. Thank you, Chair. On the question of accreditation, gentlemen, the Scottish Land and Estates submission to us referred to the Wildlife Estates Scotland accreditation programme, and I'd like to know, which I understand is administered by the Scottish Land and Estates, what external input was there from other organisations or groups into developing the accreditation requirements or assessing applications?
Well, it's initiated and supported by Scottish Land and Estates, but it had support from the outset from Scottish Natural Heritage. They've been very much behind it. From the Cairngorms National Park Authority, they were very supportive. On the sort of expert panel, the specialists who help with it, we have RSPB. They've been on it right from the outset. Game and Wildlife Conservation Trust. Mm-hmm. The accreditation is run by a professional accreditation body who, they used to be Scottish Food Quality Certification, they now have another name, but it is, it's the same one who do some of the farming schemes, so they're a professional accreditation body. So we, you know, the idea at the outset was that it should be as broad a broader church of support as could be, and that is still happening. And there are discussions with other organisations, other agencies as well, to support it.
That's quite well spread, and the input into the accreditation programme.
We very much hope so. I mean, it is a slow burn. It's building up slowly in terms of the number of estates taking part. And as the number of estates increases, the bank of data that it produces becomes more and more helpful. And as each year goes on, that, you know, one can see patterns in wildlife species. I think We've mentioned that the number of golden eagles on accredited estates can now be counted, and this sort of thing is developing.
Right, thank you. Thank you, Chair.
Thank you. Brian Whittle.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Dr. Sheridan, Mr. Baines. I wonder if you accept it, given the relatively few numbers of raptors, any persecution is significant, and I wonder if you accept that those who break the law are almost forcing the hand of the legislators. And given that, there have been discussions around the efficiency of self-regulation, and I wonder if you could explain how that's working in practice, and is there any liaison or engagement with enforcement agencies?
I'll answer that very briefly. Yes, raptor populations may be relatively low compared to the numbers of other bird species, but they do tend to be top predators, and Scotland has reasonably healthy populations of most raptor species, and as Tim alluded to, the golden eagle has increased 20% since 2003. There have been a couple of good breeding seasons for hen harriers, so we expect possibly when the hen harrier survey completes, that might indicate an increase in that population as well. But we are talking of over 500 pairs of hen harriers, over 500 pairs of golden eagles, for instance. We're not talking about small numbers, and these are territorial birds, so they're usually well spread out. But we do accept that the killing of any bird prey is very damaging for the shooting industry. And I work for an organisation that deals with shooting and conservation, and people say, how can you do that when people allegedly involved in shooting are involved in any form of wildlife crime? So it's in our best interest to stamp this out as best we can. And that's why we do work with as many other agencies as possible. Tim mentioned that we're all organisations are members of the Partnership for Action Against Wildlife Crime, and we do work very effectively, we hope, with them. An example was a sharing best practice event open to the general public, and that was to demonstrate to the general public how to identify wildlife crime if they come across it. And I was certainly happy to take part in that process, pointing out to the general public legitimate land management tools such as trapping and snaring and how these could be abused in certain situations. So the public were trained to recognise when abuse was taking place. So we're quite happy to work with the public and other agencies to ensure that as many people as possible know what is a legitimate wildlife management activity and what is potentially illegal and should be brought to the attention of the police. We also train the police in these management techniques as well.
Thank you. In the foreword to the Wildlife Crime Annual Report, the Cabinet Secretary welcomes the reduction in raptor persecution offences, but did so with caution, making reference to the review she has instructed into missing satellite tag bird of prey. What are your views on whether a clear trend in raptor persecution can be demonstrated until the findings of this review are known?
Well, I think the if you look at, since the government statistics have been produced, this is the fourth one, we think that there's a definite downward trend in bird of prey crime. I mean, it is quite confusing, some of the way the statistics and police and other figures are worked, but I think that underneath there is a definite trend downwards, and that's what we definitely see that on the ground as well. And in respect of the minister's forward and the examination of the satellite tagging, we welcome that because what we need on this is evidence, and so often this is what's lacking in the whole field of wildlife crime, and particularly raptor crime, is hard evidence as to what has happened. And so we think that is the right approach, and we particularly note that in the recent cases of satellite tags stopping working, although there was no bird of prey found dead and the police weren't treating them as crimes, we don't know why the RSPB collected this data for 5 years and never came to speak to the people who owned the land where the satellite tags had last been recorded, because that, if they had come and spoken to the relevant landowners, we might well have been able to find out what had happened. So we do support finding more evidence.
Okay, and just can I say, do you have a view as to whether the increase in recorded raptor persecution offences illustrates that there are valid concerns about raptor persecution?
We very much recognise the valid concerns. We don't deny it, but we think that the figures show a downward trend. I mean, that seems very obvious. There is a I think the agenda has mentioned the disaggregated police crime data, and I don't want to get into the technicalities of this report, but there is a time lag between the police how they calculate and the figures, and I think I would refer the committee to page 37, the number of incidents which have gone down by one this last year from 19 to 18, but that is following a general downward trend over the last 5 years.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, Angus MacDonald.
Okay, thanks, Convener. Your earlier comments regarding the RSPB are noted. Some of the decisions taken by the RSPB recently have been a mystery to many of us. You'll be aware that issues relating to game bird hunting have also recently been considered by the UK Parliament, also through petitions, one of which called for a ban on driven grouse shooting. Now, as you know, SLE questioned whether the potential environmental, economic, community and cultural impact had been taken into account in that petition. However, the petition we have before us calls for licensing rather than a ban. So can you outline whether your concerns about licensing would cover the same potential impacts as SLE have identified in their submission?
Yes. The call, as I said at the start of my introduction, was for state-regulated licensing system for game bird hunting in Scotland. And that actually confuses me because I'm not sure whether it is set at the individual level or at a collective level for a shoot. So is the shooter to be licensed, or is it to be the shoot, which would be either the land or the collective group of people who come together formally or informally to shoot, were they to be licensed? So some of the evidence that has been presented before confuses me as to whether it's at the individual level or at a more collective level. And I've been trying to make the point that at the individual level, the shooter is already licensed. It's a state-run scheme administered by the police, and it is worked at the civil burden of proof, which is exactly what the petitioners want. So my argument is that the shotgun certificate is effectively a shoot license in itself. But if we're talking at a more collective level, it's difficult to see how a shoot license could actually be administered. We don't know, for example, whether it would be based on land or whether it would be based on people coming together formally or informally. So it's something that hasn't occurred in Europe before, as far as I'm aware. So it's new territory if it is at that collective basis, and that's certainly what concerns me. And it would concern me because it would be a bureaucratic and costly form of licensing, which would be another burden on shoots. Majority of shoots are small and informal, and it could well lead, as I mentioned earlier, to them being totally disbanded. It could well lead to landowners thinking it's not worth the trouble, and therefore the shoot could collapse, and the conservation benefits coming from shoot management would also disappear.
Okay, thank you.
If I could just add, I mean, mm-hmm. I think that was the what seemed to come out of the Westminster debate was this this unknown, unquantified impact. I mean, obviously, a ban on driven grouse shooting would have a very serious impact on the uplands in England. But I would echo what Colin said, that it would be this loss of confidence and this loss of willingness to go out and do the unpaid conservation work. People would just, it would be another reason for not doing it, and I think it could undermine all sorts of aspects of rural life.
Okay, thank you. Alison Johnson.
Thank you very much, Convener. Thank you both for your statements this morning. There are some parts of your statement I agree with wholeheartedly. Perhaps your four-point plan might be something that would work very nicely alongside a licensing regime. I think there are other parts, your views on Moorburn perhaps aren't shared by everyone. There are concerns about deterioration of soil, degradation of peatland and so on, but I'd like to sort of focus specifically on this issue of licensing. Now, you've said yourself that two-thirds of land is being impacted by these activities, so I think there is growing public interest in this agenda, and I'm certainly aware of it through my own mailbag, as I'm sure colleagues are. But specifically on the issue of raptor persecution, the 2015 National Golden Eagle Survey informs that where Golden Eagle Range occupancy is only 39% in east of Scotland, where the dominant land use is driven grouse shooting. There's a good food supply there compared to 95% in the North West Highlands. So what do you think the difference is there?
Yes, that is what we've seen, and I had a look at the summary report of the survey. I mean, the east of Scotland has had that level of occupancy for decades now, and in fact, the level of breeding success in the east of Scotland is the highest anywhere. There seems to be a definite you know, the highest levels of occupancy are in the west of Scotland, the Western Isles, and it gradually decreases to the east. But one interesting thing that come out of that report is that the area south central Highlands, which has had the highest increase in occupancy, I think it was 70%. I mean, that is an area running down the spine of the Highlands, which includes a lot of driven grouse moor areas as well. So I think it's a like all of these things, it's a really complicated picture. But you know, there are grouse moor managers are passionate about golden eagles. They really do want them, and I think there are things happening in the eastern Highlands that are the reason for low occupancy could be many other than just the fact that there is grouse shooting there.
Perhaps, but it does seem perhaps a relationship that we need to investigate seriously, and I would suggest that if this issue does, and I hope it does, go to the Environment Committee in the Parliament, perhaps one they could look at further.
Yeah.
A recently published scientific report commissioned by SNH pointed out that there's been no decline in levels of illegal killing of red kites in the north of Scotland. Does this not fly in the face, perhaps, of your assertions that raptor persecution is in decline?
I think there was that report was about, it looked at it all over Scotland, and I think the red kites in other parts of Scotland were doing very well, but they could do better in the north of Scotland. I mean, we can only echo if there is raptor persecution, it needs to be condemned and it needs to be stopped. And I think we were quite clear about that in when that report came out.
You've suggested that we have one of the we're more regulated than other parts of the UK, but it appears, and I know SNH are undertaking a review at the moment of European neighbours, that we're the least regulated and most intensive game bird shooting system in Europe. Now, in a recent article in the Shooting Times, the British Association for Shooting and Conservation suggested that a licensing system where a right to shoot is dependent on legal and sustainable management is a threat to the socio-economic and environmental benefits of game bird shooting in Scotland. Do you agree?
Yes. As I pointed out earlier, I have argued that there is a lot of licensing in place already in Scotland, and to introduce another tier may actually just replicate what we already have in place if it's at the individual level. So for an individual to have to apply for his shotgun certificate to give him the tool to allow him to go and shoot, and then apply for a separate license and then get permission of the landowner, I feel would just be going a bit too far. And there are other impositions that are coming through just now. All owners of land will be faced with the prospect of sporting rates being introduced from next year onwards, and the licensing system relating to air weapons is coming into effect on the 1st of January as well. So shooters and those who shoot in Scotland are being faced with a number of financial impositions. We see shoot licensing as being another one, and it could lead to the end, as I said, of some of the smaller informal shoots that are the mainstay of shooting for ordinary people.
Thank you very much, Convener. Now, clearly this activity has an impact on the entire ecosystem. You know, I do think there should be a system in place where we understand how many animals have been shot, you know, how many hares have been culled, for example, so on and so forth. So I do think any well-designed legislation would take account of the concerns you have about duplication. Mm. But if you maintain the regulation of shooting is a threat, isn't that an acknowledgement that the current shooting management system is in fact undermined by unsustainable and illegal practice? I mean, surely estates that are being well run have simply got nothing to hide.
I would argue, yes, that estates that are well-run have got nothing to hide, but estates that are well-run may have difficulty in accommodating increased bureaucratic levels. The voluntary approach is working well, and the Wildlife Estate Scotland initiative is a good example of that voluntary approach. And the voluntary approach is one that shooting has been built on over the last 150 years in this country. Things have improved enormously. There has been legislation as when it's required. But as I said, Scotland is well regulated just now with respect to shooting. And the voluntary approach also takes it much further forward. There's the Code of Good Shooting Practice. There's lots of codes of practice for all sorts of different aspects. And we certainly promote these codes of practice. We write most of them. And we expect all of our members to abide by the codes of practice as well as the law.
Okay. Okay, thank you very much. I think we've really come to the end of our questions, although it may have raised more questions in everybody's minds. I don't know if there's any final points you want to make before we think about how might we deal with the petition? No?
Great, thank you.
Okay, I wonder if committee members now have any views on what action we take on this petition. Angus?
So it's convenient. I think... given we've spent longer than we normally would by asking for the alternative view to the petitioner's view, I think we should refer the petition to the ECCLR committee for consideration as part of its scrutiny of the Wildlife Crime Annual Report and also other upcoming work that the committee may well have in the after the Christmas recess. Mm-hmm. And I know that the committee have been following progress of the petition at this committee up till now.
Yeah, I mean, I think it has been useful to have today's session, which really highlights the kind of range of issues that that we'd be focused for. It doesn't feel to me that it's necessarily the role of this committee now then to pursue that, but I don't know what other members think about Angus's proposal.
I think we've gone round this from every angle, and I think we've made sure that we've got a very balanced view from both sides. I can't see how we how much further we can take this without passing it on, and I would agree with Angus.
Yes, I agree with that. I think we should pass it on to the ECCLR committee to take it forward from here. I think we've exhausted it as far as we can go.
Okay. Mr. Chair, I welcome the information today from Dr. Shedden and Mr. Baines. I think it gives us a good balanced approach to where we are and certainly what is in place and what needs to be put in place in relation to some of the issues that the petitioners have made. But I think it really is a matter now for the ECCLR committee to consider. We've really exhausted it as far as we can. But I do appreciate the reports that the two gentlemen gave. I think it was very useful to see the balance on that. And I would commend them for that.
Okay. Yes, I think we're in agreement then that we should refer the petition to the ECCLR committee for its consideration as part of its scrutiny of the wildlife crime annual report, which means it won't come back to this committee, but the issues have clearly been highlighted today in earlier sessions. Will, at the discretion of that committee, be explored further? And with that, can I thank our witnesses for attending today. We'll just suspend for a couple of seconds till we go. back to order again, and can we move to agenda item 2, consideration of new petitions. The first of these, petition 1622, to make failure to recycle a criminal offence. Petition 1622 by Stephen Duff calls for failure to recycle to be made a criminal offence. The petition collected 10 signatures in support. Members have a copy of the petition text and background from the Spice briefing, which provides information on the progress in managing household waste in Scotland and how that measures against the Scottish Government's targets. The briefing also provides some information on recycling arrangements elsewhere in the UK and Europe. I wonder if members have any views and action to take on this petition.
Be enforceable.
I think there is an issue about enforcement, although I was quite intrigued. I must absolutely confess that when I first looked at this petition, I thought you can't make it a criminal offence, and then when you actually read the background, you see different countries have moved to kind of not just create incentives but to create disincentives not to comply. I find that quite interesting.
I think it is very, very complex. I think it would be very, very difficult to enforce. I think it's really up to the local authorities to bring home the fact that recycling in their own area is up to target. I don't think it's realistic to say that we should introduce legislation for this.
But you wonder what support local authorities. I mean, local authorities and we have to meet targets. The targets are quite significant.
Yeah. Yeah.
If you establish a target, presumably you have to have a means of reaching that target.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
How would we... I don't know what the answer is, but it did feel to me at least it was asking some questions that might be worth pursuing.
I think so. I mean, for instance, I live in a flat and we can't recycle. We don't have recycling facilities, so I don't know how it would mean an enormous change from the local authorities to actually, provide that service,
mm-hmm.
which I'm not saying they shouldn't, but I don't think that's the way to do it.
Mm-hmm.
I'm kind of interested to see, or your thoughts on what kind of legislation could be brought into play and what that then means in enforcement terms for the local authority.
Mm-hmm.
It's not something that I'm particularly knowledgeable about, mm-hmm. but I'd be interested to think where you think that legislation would take us.
Well, one of the things we might ask the Scottish Government, I guess, is how do they propose to get to it? I mean, it is an astonishing target. 70% of recycling, composting, preparing for the use of waste from households, 70% by 2025.
Mm-hmm.
And the petitioner says that with the recent rate of increases in recycling, it would take 42 years to achieve the Scottish Government's position.
Yeah,
I won't be here to see it, but there you go.
I'll be
getting recycled by that point.
You'll be pickled. You'll be pickled and put down in the foyer. In my house, I've got five recycle bins. So I think I pretty much recycle everything.
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes I find my kids in there and everything's ridiculous. But,
We do our own recycling because we don't have bins provided.
Yeah.
So I don't know. It's obviously a massive undertaking to sort all that out.
Mm-hmm.
And there's also an issue about sort of deprivation and affluence. The more affluent areas are better at recycling than the more deprived areas and things like that. So it's a huge, huge issue.
That's actually a good point.
I mean, some of the whole thing around littering and, not using your bins properly sometimes mm-hmm. kind of relates to antisocial behaviour as
mm-hmm.
well. I mean, would I be right to say that we're not convinced that criminalising not recycling is the way to go, but it does raise quite interesting questions.
Yeah.
It might be worth asking the Scottish Government to seek its views on the action called for in the petition
mm-hmm.
in the context of their own targets
mm-hmm.
Around the recycling and the reuse of waste.
I think that would be worth it. Yeah.
Yeah,
I think that would be worth it.
Okay.
Can I just interject? We've just gone through a massive change in Argyll Bute Council, of which I'm a councillor, and we've gone the route of much better information to all the communities and all the towns, and it's beginning to work well, and we've got quite a high record of recycling.
Mm-hmm.
And one of the issues is, I mean, just an example, we looked at our own household waste. I now put out one ordinary type, the green bin, we call it, so, it's a standard waste, and it's now only a quarter of what it was at the beginning of the year.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that's right. And everything, there's so much more you can recycle. And the problem is that people are not being told by the individual councils exactly what they can recycle.
Mm-hmm.
That's the problem.
So it may not be legislation. It may
no.
be that it's further
actually, it's actually empowering the local authorities, and this is what we've done. We've empowered ourselves to, well, the officers, to go out there and persuade, and if necessary, bring in bylaw regulation at that level. Local authority. It's really down to the local authorities to do it, because they've got the teams who go around. We're not quite into photographing bins, but that does happen in some areas, and then people are warned. But it is an education process, and I think this is really taking a sledgehammer to crack a nut, whereas actually education and communication could be done. And there are more things coming out during the course of the year. I don't know if other people agree, but certainly in my area, council area, we've had a big, big effort on this.
I would just like to know which bin I'm supposed to put out each week.
Okay.
That'd be really helpful.
Okay, Angus?
Yeah, thanks, convener. Just to concur with Maurice Corey, I think it is the responsibility of the local authorities, but I'm aware that there is a pot of money sitting at Zero Waste Scotland that can be tapped into by local authorities to improve the education of the residents with regard to recycling. So there is money there for it. It's up to local authorities to tap into it.
Mm-hmm. Okay, I mean, I think it's not entirely a negative story. I mean, I think people recycle more than ever have done in the past. I expect my children's generation are much more aware than the previous generation, so there's something there. I wonder, as well as writing to Scottish Government, we might write to COSLA and just clarify, because it may be that they feel they need some legislative support. And I do note from the evidence we were given that, the idea of giving people incentives, I suppose, it's like carrots as opposed to sticks, doesn't work, according to this report anyway, but these may be issues that we could usefully flag up to see what the response we get. Is that agreed?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you very much, and we can thank the petitioner for raising these issues. The next petition is petition 1624 on the definition of adultery. The next new petition we will consider today is petition 1624 by Acri Jones on the definition of adultery. Members have a copy of the petition and a briefing note. The briefing explains that the issues raised in the petition were considered in the Marriage and Civil Partnership Scotland Bill, which became the 2014 Act. The petitioner brought a petition in substantially similar terms in the last session of Parliament after that bill was passed. The previous petition was closed on 31st of March 2015 on the basis that there was no intention to legislate further in this area in Session 4. The petitioner contends that the current definition of adultery breaches equalities in human rights law. As the issues were considered by the Parliament fairly recently, I would suggest that we write out to the Scottish Government in the first instance, seeking its current view on the issue raised by the petition and whether there is an intention to consult or legislate on the issue in the current Parliament. And I'm happy to hear members' views. Angus?
Yeah, I think that's the best course of action. We had clarification in the last session that there was no intention to legislate ever. You know, there's every possibility that could change. So,
good. I agree, and I have some sympathy with this petition and think that there's definitely some merit in pursuing it on the issue of equality.
Chair, I agree with Rona. I think that times have moved on, and I think we are where we are with civil marriages and civil partnerships and marriages between same-sex couples, and I think we just have to move forward. And yes, I agree, it's got to have to be a government issue.
Okay, is that agreed? Okay, in that case, if we agree to write to the Scottish Government seeking its view on the petition and whether it intends to legislate on this issue in the current session of the Scottish Parliament.
Chair, can I just make a point? Brian and I have been sort of named in the petitioner's comments. Yes, I believe we were written to, but that was as far as it got. We didn't express one way or other to that point.
I did. I received an email from the petitioner, and which I acknowledged receipt of said petition, all of a sudden my name appears with Maurice as people they have sought support of. So I'd just like to make that note that I think it's slightly misleading.
Yeah, it's a distinction between seeking support and receiving support, which I think most people would be aware of.
Yeah.
Okay, with that, can we move on then to agenda item 3, consideration of continued petitions? We will deal firstly with petition 1223 on school bus safety, and can I welcome Stuart Stevenson, MSP, who has, I know, a long-standing interest in the issues we're now going to be discussing. The next petition we will consider is petition 1223 by Ron Beattie on school bus safety. At our last consideration of the petition, we agreed to write to Transport Scotland. We sought clarification from it on its response to a pilot programme on school bus signage conducted by Glasgow City Council. Transport Scotland has provided a response indicating that it considers that a one-size-fits-all approach to this issue is not merited and the case has not been made for a national rollout. Members will see from the clerk's note that Transport Scotland has undertaken a range of other measures, including contacting the UK Government to enhance awareness of the school bus sign in the highway code and driving test. As members know, we received the very sad news that Mr Beattie passed away since we last considered the petition, and I'm sure members will wish to join me in expressing our condolences to Mr Beattie's family and in recognising Mr Beattie's efforts in raising this issue with the Scottish Parliament over many years. It's worth noting that Transport Scotland's submission, dated 21st of September, commended Mr Beattie for his achievements in influencing Scottish policy on this issue. And I'm sure other members will agree with me that even in reading the evidence that he provided, it's a very powerful message about the need for action. But I wonder if members have any comments or suggestions on how we now take this petition forward. I don't know if you want to say, perhaps Stuart might be worthwhile if you... made your comments.
Thank you very much indeed, Convener, and I'm sure Ron Beattie's family will very much appreciate the kind remarks that you've made, and indeed the comments that Transport Scotland made before he died, which of course, being prospective, are possibly even higher, like more highly valued. It's worth just making the general comment that Ron Beattie, following an accident involving his granddaughter, first petitioned the Scottish Parliament on the whole issue of school bus safety in 2004. He is, I think, beyond doubt, the most persistent but one of the most effective petitioners, and it would be a good model for others who wish to pursue in a proper, mannerly way how to deal with difficult issues, which this one is. Now, turning to the subject that's before us today, I think the response from Transport Scotland is perfectly proper. They do, in particular, in relation to school bus signs, which is one of the two topics of the petition, identify that in their tests only 11% of people identified these signs in hazard perception tests in daylight conditions, 8% or so in darkness. I think that does broadly leave open the question as whether more can be done, but I think noting that the Highway Code has been amended at Rule 209 and that the test is being amended to try and raise awareness of this, I think we can count that a very substantial and real achievement, but perhaps not the closing of the issue in the long term. I think the other point the committee may care to consider is of course the other point that is in the petition, and that is to make overtaking a stationary school bus a criminal offence. I'm not sure that's within the gift of the Scottish Parliament, I may say. I believe it is not. And I suggest that perhaps the only further thing that the committee might consider doing, I'm not urging, I'm merely informing, is, of course, to ask the Rural Committee, who have responsibility for transport in this Parliament, whether there are issues from this petition, including stationary school buses and offences associated with that, whether they might care to consider this further. I suspect for this committee, this petition having gone on from 2009 and notched up a fair number of achievements and changes, you may be running out of options, Convener.
Thanks very much. Understand that the question of overtaking and so on is reserved. I think there's a broader issue just about mindset amongst drivers. Certainly in my time as a school teacher, we lost young people who've been classically been knocked down coming round the front of the bus. So I think there is an issue about mindset, which I don't know if you can legislate for, but I think even the fact that these issues have been discussed and raised over a period of time, I'm sure I've had some impact on public perceptions. I wonder if people have views on... I mean, it does feel to me that we would want to close the petition under Rule 15.7 on the basis that Transport Scotland has identified alternative measures to address the issues raised by the petition, but I wonder if people have views specifically on Stuart Stevens' suggestion that we maybe just flag up to the relevant committee these broader questions he's identified. Brian?
I think it's quite interesting one here is the overtaking of a stationary bus makes the assumption that we can identify the bus as being a school bus in the first instance and having school children aboard the bus at the time. So it's almost like a dual issue. I do think that being able to properly identify the bus as a school bus is key, but the overtaking of a stationary bus being a criminal offence, I think, would be problematic. Mm-hmm. But as you say, it's the mindset of drivers more is probably more akin to highway code. And
I mean, a city like Glasgow, very few of the buses will be school buses. They will be buses with school children on them.
Yeah.
And the examples I would have given from my own teaching career would have been youngsters who would have been on the regular buses. So that is, you know, in a sense, all of this doesn't really address that question, which is just about at certain times of the day, quarter to nine in the morning, 4 o'clock, 3:30 in the afternoon, drivers should be very alive to the fact that people coming on and off buses will include large numbers of young people. But that doesn't feel to me that something even that Transport Scotland could address.
It does feel to me that we should be doing something, but unhelpfully, I can't think of what.
You know, I'm minded to say it should go on to the Rural Committee, but just to clarify, would it be going there just on the issue of overtaking school buses? Is there any other reason it would be going there?
Just to what we would
flag
be doing
up general
saying
safety.
We're closing the petition. We recognise there are issues here around transport, and the relevant committee is responsible for transport. Mm-hmm. We just write to them saying, almost capturing this debate and saying we would welcome... They may look at this further.
I would support that, definitely. I mean, I think Ron has made some fantastic achievements just reading through the background to it. And I think it would be a good idea to move it on to the relevant committee now. I don't think we can take it any further, but certainly move it on to the relevant committee.
Yeah. Can I just ask a question? Do we have any statistics reference municipal and rural accidents?
Sorry,
do we have any statistics sort of showing us what the occurrence is in rural and municipal?
I think there are some figures in the report, but I mean, I think just to clarify, if we close the petition, what we're doing, we're writing to the relevant committee and saying these are issues that we've considered. We can't direct them then to what they might do with that, but that would be something we would just. In their own work programme, maybe something that they would wish to look at. And I think if they wanted to examine that, I think there probably will be, Stuart Stevenson will know better than I, what figures there are. But whether it captures both youngsters travelling on school transport and those travelling on regular buses, I'm not sure.
I think what Stuart Stevenson says is the rural nature of it is actually important. That's something the Rural Committee can look at. But I do know, sorry, coming back to my own, Argyll and Bute Council, we've started to put wardens on buses. At the school time, and that has helped. But that's
it's not so much that there's a rural issue, but the Rural Affairs Committee also is responsible for transport.
Oh, sorry, yes, I beg your pardon. Right, yes, okay,
Okay. Can we agree then that we will close the petition, but we will take the actions that have been discussed? And can I thank Stuart Stevenson for his attendance? And I do think we would want again to acknowledge the work of Mr. Beattie and his family in this regard, where if that is a legacy, it's one certainly to be proud of.
Okay. Thank you very much, Convener.
Okay. If we can now move on then to petition 1408, the updating of pernicious anaemia vitamin B12 deficiency understanding and treatment. This petition is petition 1408 by Andrea MacArthur on updating pernicious anaemia vitamin B12 deficiency understanding and treatment. The committee has a copy of the Scottish Government's latest response and a submission from the petitioner. Members will recall that since the petition was lodged, the British Committee for Standards in Haematology published guidelines on the diagnosis of B12 and folate deficiency in June 2014. The Scottish Government received advice from the Diagnostic Steering Group that these guidelines were not suitable for the Scottish practice setting. As such, the Scottish Government commissioned the Scottish Haematology Society to prepare a summary document based on the guidelines provided to GPs in Scotland. The Session 4 Public Petitions Committee considered the draft guidelines for the first time at its meeting on 1 December 2015. The committee sought further information from the Scottish Government and the Scottish Haematology Society on the draft document to clarify a number of the petitioner's concerns with it. The Scottish Haematology Society has since withdrawn from the process, citing its limited resources as the main reason for doing so. The latest submission from the Scottish Government advises that no further work will be done in the draft summary document and there are no plans to publish it. As such, Scottish clinicians will be expected to refer to the British Committee for Standards and Haematology's guidelines. The petitioner has expressed disappointment with this news in her latest submission, and I wonder if members have any suggestions for action.
Given the disappointment on the outcome, why don't we write to the Minister for Public Health asking why they're expected to go to the PCSH for guidelines? And they were, I think, previously considered, you see, not suitable for use in Scottish practice settings. So.
Yes, it did strike me as odd saying that these guidelines weren't suitable, and then when the Scottish Haematology Society withdrew, they then say, well, they are suitable. So I wonder if it be, and we agreed then that we write to the Minister for Public Health. Yeah. I'm just trying to.
Yeah.
Okay, is that agreed?
Yes.
Okay. Thank you very much. If we can then move on to petition 1463, an effective thyroid and adrenal testing diagnosis and treatment. You will be aware that this is an issue of interest to Elaine Smith, MSP, but she's unable to be with us today. This petition is by Lorraine Cleaver on effective thyroid and adrenal testing diagnosis and treatment. Members will recall at our meeting on 29 September 2016 that we agreed to request a briefing from SPICE and to consider our approach to the petition at a future meeting. A copy of the SPICE briefing has been provided to members. Since then, we've also had a chance to consider our approach to the petition within the context of our work programme. And I wonder if members have suggestions for action.
Rona? I think this is a hugely, hugely important issue, and you know, I think the suggestion that we prepare a report on it, and I would really like to see a debate in the chamber on this. I mean, I appreciate it's been fairly long standing, but I think it's we need to try and move it on somehow.
Mm-hmm. Okay. I think there's no doubt whatsoever that we've accumulated, or the petitions committee rather than we as a collective group here, but over a period of time have accumulated a whole range of information which would be really useful to draw together in one place. And again, I think with the seeking a debate in the chamber, we would then secure the response of a government minister, which would then allow people to, you know, whether across the chamber, individual MSPs or groups beyond the parliament itself, might be able to pursue these issues and highlight them. Is that agreed? Angus?
Yeah, well, I was just going to agree with you, Convener. As you say, we've collated a massive amount of evidence on this, and it will be good to have a report collating all that information. And clearly a debate in the Chamber will help to keep this major issue on the radar, particularly on the Government's radar, because I, for one, don't understand why T3 is not available through GPs, and we need to get to the bottom of this once and for all.
Okay, are we agreeing?
Agreed.
Okay, thank you very much. We're now moving on to petition 1581, Save Scotland's School Libraries. The next continued petition for consideration is petition 1581, Save Scotland School Libraries, submitted by Duncan Wright on behalf of Save Scotland School Libraries. We previously considered this petition at our meeting on 29 September, when we agreed to write to the Scottish Government and the Scottish Library and Information Council. The responses are included in our briefing pack, and the note by the clerk provides a summary of these responses. The Scottish Government does not appear to object specifically to the development of a national strategy for school libraries, but does not consider that ministers are necessarily best placed to lead on this. And I wonder if members have suggestions for next steps. Matt Morris?
Yeah, I think we should write to COSLA and the Associated Directors of Education Scotland in light of the Scottish Government's response, because there are big issues running throughout all the councils, the 32 local authorities of Scotland just now, certainly in their budget setting, and this has come up time and time again, and I think we need to get a central view from COSLA on this.
I agree with that. I think we need to go to COSLA on this one. Yeah.
Okay.
See, I'm kind of intrigued to understand why ministers think they're not best placed to deal with this, since it's an education matter.
Yeah. I thought it was interesting that the government recognised there were issues but didn't see their responsibility, but equally Scottish Libraries body recognised there was a need for a strategy but didn't really identify, in my view, what should be the next step. So it's like it felt like everybody agreed it was an issue, but I'm working on the assumption that there's not people who willfully want to refuse to have school libraries and school librarians. And it would be interesting to know why are people making the decisions they're making, what are the pressures on them, and what are the core things that you would expect from school and education and the role of libraries within that. So we could write to COSLA. Association of Directors of Education Scotland may have a view as well.
I think one of the issues behind this is the fact that there is so much now referral to internet, collecting information, that the kids go home and they're encouraged that. And this is one of the dilemmas that councils are facing, is the reduction in the use of the libraries in schools, for example. Mm-hmm. But yet you go to some towns where the municipal library is actually well used. So there's a real dichotomy at the moment.
I think ideally a combination of both, you know, books and the internet.
Yes, exactly.
Working together would be good. Yeah. But,
that's why I think we should go to COSLA and get a real steer on this with the Director of Education.
I wonder whether in the many schools they will have libraries which also have facilities with computers and so on. And it's a question of what level of professional do you require? I mean, when I was teaching, we were still teaching them the Dewey Decimal System, so I don't know whether that still happens in schools. So people can just Google most things now, but I mean, I have no doubt whatsoever that librarians in their profession will have moved on along with technology, and that should be quite interesting to know. Do we think there's a role for the Education Skills Committee in looking at this question?
Well, I do. I think the, as you alluded to, convener, that there's this, I think everybody recognises an issue, but nobody seems to be able to take on the responsibility. And I would really be interested to see who it is that's making the decision and who ultimately the responsibility falls to. So I think it would be the Education and Skills Committee would be.
Okay. So we can refer it to them, we can write to COSLA and ADES, if there's anything else. Okay, and then we can obviously... now we have a choice. If we refer it to the, been advised we refer it to the Education Committee, it will not come back to us. So it's a question whether do we want to let it go at this point,
No, certainly not.
We'll do the writing and
okay.
Yeah, exactly.
And then we can reflect on that at a later stage. Okay. Thank you very much for that. If we can now move on to petition 1600 on speed awareness courses. Petition 1600 on speed awareness courses was submitted by John Chapman. At our previous consideration of this petition on 29 September, we agreed to write to the Lord Advocate to seek his views on the petition and any concerns his office may have about the effectiveness of speed awareness courses. We've received the Lord Advocate's response, which is included with our papers, and where he indicates that he would be happy to consider a detailed proposal and looks forward to the Department for Transport's report on its three-year evaluation of speed awareness courses. Do members have any suggestions for action?
I think shouldn't we really defer and until the Department for Transport has reported on the three-year speed awareness course?
Okay.
seems to.
Yeah.
I agree with that. So I think that's the point. Other absolutely.
We could also write Scottish Government seeking an update from its Strategic Partnership Board following its meeting on 28 September. I think everybody recognises the significance of this petition and its importance. So I think if we do those two things, which is getting an update but also holding on to the petition until the Department for Transport has reported in its three-year speed awareness course evaluation, and to get an we can seek an indication from them about the timescale for publication of that report. That's agreed. Okay, thank you very much for that. And now petition 1604, inquest for all deaths by suicide in Scotland. The next petition we will consider is petition 1604 by Catherine Matheson on inquest for all deaths by suicide. We've received a range of responses from NHS boards, the Scottish Government and Scottish Association for Mental Health. I think we'd want to acknowledge, actually, the seriousness with which people have responded, and very substantial papers that are associated with this petition. The petition has also provided submission to address points raised in the responses received. This petition raises a number of issues about the process employed by health authorities to review the circumstances leading to a patient on a community treatment order committing suicide. The overarching issue is whether the Scottish Government is minded to extend the scope of the review under Section 37 of the Mental Health Care and Treatment Scotland Act 2015. Following the Mental Health Commission's recommendation, the Scottish Government has already agreed to extend the scope of the review to include the suicide of patients on suspension of detention. The Minister for Public Health did not commit in her submission whether she is minded to extend the scope of the review further to include patients who were released from hospital or receiving care in the community under a compulsory treatment order that's called for by the petition. This is something the committee may wish to explore further with the Minister. Members will see that a number of stakeholders do not agree with the petition's suggestion that there should be an inquest for all deaths by suicide. However, there was some agreement that there may be merit in reviewing or reforming particular aspects of the NHS's review process that the petitioner has highlighted. This includes appointing independent chairs to conduct the reviews and sharing experience of how families can be successfully included in the review process. I wonder if members have suggestions for action or comments. I think we were struck before both by the power of the evidence from the petitioner and the dignity with which that was done, and I am struck by the seriousness with which these issues have been raised, and it's just a question of how we need to take this forward.
Excuse me, Convener, can I just say at this point that I've had a message from Catherine Matheson to offer her sincere gratitude to the committee for taking forward this issue for her family and for all other families who've lost someone to suicide. She's very, very grateful.
Okay, thank you very much for that. So, in terms of...
I think we should write to the Minister for Mental Health to ask why, you know, if she's going to expand the scope. And why that wasn't included. I think that's vital to do that. And write to Healthcare Improvement Scotland to ask their views and the guidance provided to NHS boards and, you know, a number of other points in the recommendations here. I think, you know, just as much information from them as we can on what's already been provided, but just to clarify a lot of the points.
Mm-hmm.
Mental Welfare Commission as well, I think it's important.
Yeah, we could write to them to ask for...
Yeah, I think that's important.
The view and the action.
It's view? Yeah.
Yes.
Absolutely, no, I think we go for that.
Yeah.
I mean, I think there's a... Even in reading the papers, and this is something that I've had the experience of in the past, I understand that when the NHS professionals are dealing with these questions, they don't want to be in a position where they feel that they're not able to explore what happened and address that and improve their action. But they almost feel that because the families will be there, they'll become defensive. I think from the family's point of view, they feel that their individual circumstances are not being addressed fully. It's only about what do we learn for the future rather than being properly open and accountable for what has actually happened. I think there's a tension that comes through in the responses, which says, well, we can't have the families present because it will make people defensive. And I think... if you were the family, you would think, well, what have you got to be defensive about? Yes. I think it is a very delicate area.
Yes.
Not just in suicide. I think that the across a number of areas within the NHS. But I think from the family's perspective, you know, I think what all they're looking for is closure. You know, and as you said, that the evidence that was given was very powerful, very moving, and I think it does lead to some of the conclusions that the panel already, or the committee already made here, that this should be continued to be taken forward.
I think the families are looking for closure. They're also looking for reassurance that things will change and it won't happen. You know, things will improve for families in that situation, because it's very brave of, you know, this petitioner to be fighting this, given, you know, the tragic circumstances.
I think they also want justice. I mean, I think, yes, you know, they want to feel, I don't want to put words into people's mouths, but in my experience of dealing with particular cases like this, people do want to be assured that things won't happen again for others, but they also want to know what happened and why it happened, and that if people are culpable and have been neglectful, that is also addressed, which in other circumstances would happen.
Can I just raise a point? It's quite interesting, the different NHS boards, we quote four here, Ayrshire and Arran, Highland, Forth Valley, Dumfries and Galloway and Tayside, all have a slightly different approach to the committee structure. Mm. And I think there's something in that that we may well need to be looked at, because, you know, best practice. Now, I'm not saying they're all doing anything wrong, it's just maybe there's something there could be tightened up on.
Mm-hmm. Was that something we could flag up to the Minister and to Health Improvement Scotland?
Yeah,
definitely.
So just to kind of summarise where we are, I think we're agreeing to write to the Minister for Mental Health asking whether the Scottish Government will expand the terms of Section 37 of the Mental Health Care and Treatment Act in the way called for by the petitioner, how the findings from the review into arrangements for investigating the deaths of patients will feed into national policy, including the Scottish Government's new 10-year mental health policy due to be published this year, and the timetable for bringing forward the regulations in relation to Section 22 of the Health, Tobacco, Nicotine and Care Scotland Act 2016 regarding the procedure to follow on the duty of candour. I mean, I think that, you know, this question of the fact that the petitioner's son was still under the care of the hospital, although not resident in the hospital, is actually, you know, it's not the broader question of suicide, but very specifically that. And in writing to Healthcare Improvement Scotland, really asking, I suppose, this question about guidance to NHS boards and how they feel about the fact that different boards are slightly different.
Uniformity, yeah. Uh-huh. And how they deal with it. Yeah.
And the petitioner's suggestions on improving guidance and requiring review panels to be led by independent persons. There was certainly one response which talked about the importance of the way in which that then gave confidence if the chair was independent. What its views on how health authorities can share ways in which families have been successfully engaged within the review process, including directly in review meetings, because again I think that was a tension we highlighted, and whether it considers there would be value in the action called for by the petitioner to expand the remit of the review under Section 37 of the Mental Health Care and Treatment Act. And we've already agreed, I think, to Maurice Corey's suggestion in writing to the Mental Welfare Commission.
Yes, I think so.
Okay, so that, I think, is a fairly substantial number of issues emerged from that. Is there anything else? No. Okay, thank you very much for that. And that concludes the business of the meeting, and I now close the meeting.